make his head.
Good morning.
Let me do that in a foreign language. Good morning.
Good morning.
Honey.
Honey.
They get paid in the night of the month. The new mom and I'm sure now that there's a mom and she taught by any buggy or there's a week of consul. Going in, everybody they went to Kansas City. You don't know, she made a car, in the mall and she now they always say money to. You know, by any measure, this is all in the shroom, Mr. Bunny, Mr. Bunny. They go in and give them a little while. Oh, she made a shibuya over there. Shagarashi, Kinomage, you come in. Pain in the shop. Pain in the kitchen food. You must not even let Kunaman, Chilakae, and Jacob keep the man. Oh, my, I am. We go to the streets in the way. Any questions of what I just said? Hearing none, I will proceed. I'm very much into education. I'm very much into Anishinaabe education. I'm considered one of the founders of culture-based education across the nation. Some of the things that I've developed in Indian education have been adopted and copied in Canada, in Mexico, in Japan, in Germany, and other places. Culture-based education, I believe, is the answer for all of us. As a teacher at the Shingwauk University, and having been there now for two years, I'm still very much amazed at what I find. The gaps in education are huge and deep. Some of those reasons for the gaps in our education begin at home. Some of those gaps in education are exemplified and maintained by the public school education system, of which we are either a victim or a participant, and sometimes an unwilling participant. And just to give you an idea of my own education, on my home reserve in the state of Wisconsin, I was not allowed to go to school until I was 9 years old. I did not speak a word of English up until that time. To this day, Ojibwe Moen is my first language. Ho-Chunk Winnebago is my second language. English is my third language, my acquired language. I'm not as well-versed in the English language as I am in my sacred language, which is Ojibwe. But in spite of being expelled from school on 9 different occasions, from grade 1 through grade 8, I'm sorry, there was one that happened when I was in grade 9. That's the 9th one. Mathematically, they coincide. Grade 9, expelled 9 times. You can make that correlation. There must be some systematic law that governs Indian expulsion. I managed to get through a critical system in spite of that. I graduated from high school in Terre Haute, Indiana, where I did not, where I was not expelled. I've often wondered if it was because I was a good student, maintained a B-plus average, was on the honor roll at my graduation, or if it was because I could score 24 points in a basketball game, or because I won all state honors as a running back, which I did at that school. At my own school in Hayward, Wisconsin, Indian kids were not allowed to play basketball. They were not allowed to play football. Indian girls were not allowed to be cheerleaders. Indians were not allowed to work in school. Even the bus that came to the reserve, believe it or not, there was a white bus driver that came from the school to the reservation line, and then he got off, and a full-blood Indian got on to drive us the rest of the way. That's fact. But it speaks to the way that white America viewed us at that time, and in many ways views us the same way today. So education is very important. It's very important to me, and it should be very important to us. But I think we do ourselves a disservice when we do not have our own school system. Look at your reserve. Look at reserves anywhere. There seems to be a great concern about the loss of our language. In the greater majority of the time, we are blaming somebody else for that. We are blaming somebody else for losing our language when the fault lies at home. Some of that is also the fault of the community. Look at any reserve, with the exception of a few. Where are the daycare centers that are in the language? Where are the preschool programs that are totally in the language? Where's the immersion programs in retaining and saving and carrying on the language for future generations? Where are those education programs on the reserve? So we can blame, we can use the word blame all we want to. But look at your own home. Look at your own community. Where are the language programs, and where are the elders? Where are the grandmothers and grandmothers and grandfathers and aunties and uncles that can share the language, the stories, the culture, the beauty of who we are to our children? Where are they? Most often, elders are ignored. Their service, somebody might take them a little bit of food now and then, but where are the teenagers that are visiting them to hear their stories, to talk with them, to help them? So we can blame all we want, but let's take a good look at home. If we are to have, and you hear all of the gentlemen talk about education, yes, we have great deal more of our kids graduating from college and university today than ever before. But the problem isn't solved.